Good morning, friends. This is CEC-UGC EduSet Network, and we are running a series of lectures on Indian writing in English translation. Already we have covered a large number of areas from ancient period to the medieval period and beyond. In fact, the last lectures were on 19th century. And today we take up a different topic within the series, and that concerns the trend. We cover trends, we cover authors, we cover texts, and today it's the question of trends with us. The title of the lecture today would be Folk Theatre Forms, Jatra and Qissa. So these are the trends that existed in India in the medieval period, and they have continued till now, and they hold a great relevance. Now, before I request our resource person, Dr. Payal Nagpal, to give the lecture, let me tell you, friends, that the last 10 minutes of this lecture may also be devoted to a discussion with the viewers. So if you have any questions to ask, if you have any observations to make, if you just want to reflect on things, then you are welcome to do so in the last 10 minutes of the lecture, which start with time 10:50. Let me now introduce to you again Dr. Payal Nagpal. She's been giving lectures earlier too. She teaches English literature in Janaki Devi Memorial College, Delhi University, and she is a senior teacher, senior faculty. She has worked on modern drama. She has published books. She has presented papers in international and national conferences, and she has lots of plans also to work further in the areas of her interest. So now I request Dr. Payal Nagpal to give the lecture. Dr. Payal Nagpal, welcome to the lecture, and please give your points and share them.
Thank you, Professor Prakash. Today's lecture, it will be on folk theatre forms with special reference to the Jatra and Qissa. In a previous lecture on folk theatre forms, we had discussed the Nautanki and the Tamasha specifically. So, and how, you know, there is this combination of song, dance, various instruments that are used, and in the context of the Nautanki and Tamasha, and the implications, their evolution to the form in the present day. Today we will be focusing on the Jatra and the Qissa. In the first part of the lecture today, we will discuss Jatra. Jatra is actually, the word is Yatra, and it refers to a journey. You know, it is in fact referred to especially in the context of Bengal and Orissa, and it's one of the best known form of traveling Bengali theatre. So the journey, in a sense, also can be a journey that we look at, you know, on the platform that is taking place. The yatra, or the journey itself, is also like a kind of a mini travelogue that takes place through the mind of the audience. And the significant aspect of the yatra is that it is something that pertains to popular imagination and popular sensibility. It is not something that is happening within the confines of an auditorium, but it is something that is taking place in open spaces, and hundreds and thousands of people are present there to watch a yatra performance. So again, which means that when we talk about the jatra, it has to have elements that bind it to the audience, that make sure that when the next jatra performance takes place, the audience is compelled to actually go for it and to watch these performances. So one of the things that binds the audience to the presentation that's taking place is that, you know, it pertains to some kind of a mythological story. Now, when we talk about myths and stories by which are weaved into people's lives and into also their social realities, these are ways in which they understand their immediate social constructions of family, of friendship, and various other social structures that be. So that, in a sense, is kind of brought out through the mythological stories in the context of the yatra. So if we look at the jatra form in terms of two stages, then the first will be one where there is a kind of religious procession, in the sense that if we actually go back to the beginnings, then how is it that the jatra originated? So one of the suggestions is that, you know, because people believed in a kind of performance, ritualistic performance, or related to religion. So in that context, there would be a procession, as there are many today, and they also kind of combine the religious procession with dramatic elements. So that this became a way of a kind of social participation. This procession would probably then be combined with, let's say, music, dance, maybe idols would be presented. And the second level would then be when this procession that we are talking about transforms into a kind of dramatic story. And this dramatic story would then be added to these processions. So a kind of storytelling that takes place in the procession, leading to what we understand to be the Jatra form. So there are these different platforms, and there's a kind of movement that is involved. And the Jatra in that sense then is hugely episodic also, because when there are many people watching the different aspects of the Jatra. So the sense of essentializing it into a totality or story will probably not be there. So, and of course, there is this very, very important element in a Jatra, which is that of, being essentially celebratory. So the people dance, they sing, they watch a story that is being enacted as part of the Jatra. Now, we then move on to an important question, which is that what is the nature of these stories? So these, of course, presented primarily the lives of Krishna and Ram. And, it's been pointed out that one of the popular episodes in the early Jatra form was that of Kalya Daman, or the defeat of Kalya. And later, of course, you have the episodes of Nal Damayanti and Harishchandra and so on. So, episodes, this episodic quality, in the Jatra is very, very important in that sense. And you also have, like the Jatra Pala or the chapter, you have the Palagan or the song. And when we look at the Jatra in that sense, then we look at its origins, goes back almost to the 16th century. And, Nishikant Chattopadhyay, who's worked on the Jatra form, points out that these Jatras depended on patronage of rich people and were at times performed in their courtyards. And the patronage being provided by people who had the money to encourage cultural activity of this sort is important, because it also tells us about how a kind of cohesive social participation is happening. And at times it could happen in courtyards, it could happen in open spaces, but the fact that this was something that truly rested in the sphere of the popular and was extremely creative and is contributing to the making of the culture of the popular in the sense. So, of course, the Jatra, because, these are these traveling sort of theatrical forms. So the element of exaggeration to catch the attention at the level of costume, at the level of makeup, was there. And at the same time, as I said, that, this is a kind of community activity where people sit together and watch the different Jatra processions. So the older Jatra forms focused on a kind of singing, and later, of course, they became more dramatic. And here again, I would request Professor Prakash to tell us what he thinks about the Jatra form.
What interests me, Dr. Payanagpal, in your argument is the celebratory aspect of the Jatras. They express happiness, they relate the performance with details of texts, details of episodes that occurred sometime in the past, and that sometime in the past is not bound by the usual time. Ram and Krishna, they were legends, they have been there since time immemorial. So one sees, that there is a kind of link with that past which remains present and relevant. So this is what strikes me as important in your argument, and I would say that communities in the medieval period and before, they would sometimes get a chance to, think of their problems, think of their joys, think of their pleasures. So, and this social participation is important. And if you could tell how, these social participations at that time inspired the artists, that would perhaps help.
Yes. So, because it was important, the social participatory aspect is in fact the most important part of the folk theatre forms, because in a sense the origins and the implementation, really speaking, lies within the popular imagination. And as mentioned, that there was this you know, the use of melodrama and exaggeration, the use of loud costumes and makeup to kind of catch the attention of the people who were watching it was there. And of course, these were stories that were there from, as you rightly pointed out, that, you know, these are stories that have been there for a very long time. They are legends that people kind of inherit and talk about. So each community reworks that to present it.
Singing is involved.
Yes.
Dancing is involved. Acting is involved.
Yes.
So initially this is singing and dancing, and later on it becomes also acting.
Acting.
And in the acting there is drama.
Yes.
And in the drama there can be difference of opinion.
Yeah.
One person saying something else to the other. There might be also, you know, a kind of meaningful clash between what is wrong at that time and what is right. And when the right wins at the end, then that also affords a kind of pleasure.
Yes.
So it's an activity which should have remained with us till today, because today a writer sits in a corner and just talks to an imaginary audience, imagined, you know, audience. So that was not there. The audience was just there in front of the people and participated.
Yes.
This is really fascinating.
So in fact, the older Jatra form focused on singing, and the later forms became, incorporated more of, in a sense, the dramatic element. And in fact, in the 1920s, especially as the freedom struggle gained intensity, the Jatra, like other theatrical forms, became then a way of actually spreading these ideas and encouraging people to participate in the freedom struggle to convey these ideas. And for instance, Mukundas, and there was something called the Swadeshi Jatra that became very popular. And of course, the great Utpal Dutt also later took to this form and incorporated, a kind of political spectacle as part of the Jatra form. So the Jatra, in a sense, then, you know, the from a time period where the use of myths, mythological stories, the idea of singing, all these elements were then incorporated in a sense, by later generations, and right up to Utpal Dutt, we are talking about the adaptation in a sense of the Jatra form. So which meant that the whole question of the ability of the Jatra actor, what were the qualities that that an actor who's part of the Jatra was supposed to have? So to sing, to be able to dance, to mime, and to the whole idea of abhinay, act and perform, was very, very important. Another very significant aspect that one needs to understand in the context of the traveling Jatra forms is that urbanization of the city, especially in the context of the development of Calcutta as a city, in a sense. So was very, very significant, and it impacted the Jatra in a certain manner, where with the advent of modernity, in a sense, the idea of plot and characterization became very important. So which meant that the rather nebulous or loose structure of the Jatra then became a more compact and composite one. And of course, the broad parameters of what constitute a Jatra remain there. But as I've just pointed out, that we have the Swadeshi Jatra, we have Utpal Dutt using the Jatra form to explain certain ideas and beliefs. So but this begins somewhere with this the two things together: one, the freedom struggle on one side, and gradually in the 20th century, the making of the city that leads to a kind of reworking, in a sense, of the Jatra form. And
at this stage, I would like to put a question to you, Dr. Nawpal, that is regarding the use of the courtyard. Courtyard means that the family of the rich person who is funding the Jatra, performance, would be there. There will be neighbors also coming to attend it.
Yes.
And the whole courtyard will be full of people.
Yes.
And in full view of these people, the performers will come and do their work, present their things. So would there be a kind of interaction between the audience and the performers? Would there be an interaction between one performer with another? Would this thing be there at that time? Any idea? Any guess?
The connections between the performers on the platform, because it's happening in the courtyard, so the stage is something that is going to be set up. So of course, wooden stages, wooden platforms, and again with those Petromax lamps and so on in those days. So I think the use of humor particularly would bind the audience to what is happening on the stage.
Would some people from the audience be allowed to also sometimes dance with the performers? Can that be imagined?
I think that can be imagined, especially in the in their own space, or even if you know, one of them were to actually go up and perform, and or maybe let's say dance. And of course, this brings to mind Bertolt Brecht, and you know, the whole idea of you know, getting the audience, you know, the use of alienation and so on. So yes, I think that possibility would certainly have been there.
Actually, in my childhood, you know, I saw this kind of performance in the courtyard of a rich person in my small town, and I saw, you know, that some cases when the bhajan was sung, when it was sung at that point of time, the audience would actually sing along with the performance. And when, as you rightly point out, there is humor, then people would laugh and enjoy. And sometimes, you know, the character in the performance would think of certain people in the audience and would like to mimic. So that way it became really participatory, as you say.
In fact, that brings another very interesting idea, that today when we talk about theater, we look at it primarily in terms of proscenium theater and understand it. Of course, I mean, we have a very rich, thriving idea of street theater, campus theater and so on. But like, you know, the mainstream mode is imagined, you know, by people, let's say, who are not affiliated with literary studies, is imagined to be that of the proscenium, where the notion of the real is kind of put forth. And the point that you just made about, you know, the actors performing or singing on stage and the audience kind of supporting them by singing along or laughing. So when they laugh, there is this realization that these are not real people. In that sense, they are performing the role of a particular mythological character. And that creates that idea that they are watching a spectacle. I think that is something that is central to primarily all folk theatre forms.
And you have at the same time also talked about the use of this particular trend by the national movement.
Yes.
Which means that ideas were brought in rather consciously later, so that they could spread from the performers among the audience.
Absolutely. Again, I mean, the Bura Katha from Andhra makes use of the same thing, and how you know, the folk theatre form, that structure is something that makes it, because it is so flexible, because it is something that is open to adaptation, it is open to a kind of transformation that allows us to use it within a new context. So if that context is that of the freedom struggle, we can use it in that context, or maybe you know, in the I mean, post the freedom struggle in an emerging India, how would we use the Jatra form, for instance? So there is a kind of flexibility in folk theatre structures.
And you also talked about the connect between Jatra and the street theatre today.
Yes.
So which means that Jatra would inspire people today who are into activism to take the ideas and the performance to the street.
Street.
Yes. This is also there.
Yes, this is
so
also.
In a way, Jatra is a kind of a mother of the street theatre today.
Today.
It inspires.
Yes. And I think this whole idea of participatory mechanisms within folk theatre forms such as the Jatra is very important. And I think the street theatre gets the whole participatory sense from there. So that is very, very important. The fact that, you know, people from different walks of society can stand together and watch the Jatra, that is important. And as mentioned right at the beginning, that it in a sense then also becomes a kind of mini travel that's happening in the minds of the audience. They are being taken through something that's at the level
Could you explain it further? This is a good point.
So a kind of mini travelogue that takes place in the minds of the audience, and one is at the level of what they are watching on stage, let's say the legend or the mythological story, and how it pertains to their life, the idea of right or wrong, but how they interpret it and make it a part of their own journey. Or, you know, making it a part of their own life and their own social reality. I think that connection is very strong in folk theatre forms, and you know, especially, as I said, in the context of the Jatra. So again, however, of course, with in the post-independence era, the Jatra form underwent further change, and new mediums of publicity, and you know, led to a kind of institutionalization in the sense of the Jatra form, where a kind of structure emerged. Whereas earlier, I would think that, you know, the structure was more fluid and more flexible. And with for instance, that the Jatra performance, which went on for many hours, would then, in the context of, let's say, the city space and a certain kind of understanding of the Jatra, would then be interpreted in terms of one can say, let's say, 3 to 4 hours of a performance, a lot of critics of people who have researched on the Jatra have said that the advent of cinema in that sense has also had an impact, and a kind of slightly maybe a narrowing of the structure then emerges because the duration for which the audience attention is captured undergoes a change with the emergence of, let's say, the city, especially in the post-independent India construct. We also look at the Yatra form in the context of another state, which is Orissa. So we know the Jatra primarily in the context of Bengal, but we also need to look at the Jatra in the context of Orissa, and how in Orissa these were dedicated, the stories were dedicated more towards Ram as compared to the primarily Krishna dominated one in Bengal. And in Orissa, the Jatra is broadly called the Sahi, and it does not use dialogue. So, and costume gesture is used to depict characters and episodes from the Ramayana. So, and it is believed that, in Dhirendash points out how in the context of Orissa, from the Jatra form emerges the arena style of theatre, the whole idea that the audience is sitting on all sides or at least three sides, and the performance is happening in the centre. And as Professor Prakash just pointed out, that in a sense, one can clearly see the connections between the Jatra as a theatre form and the street theatre. So it is, in the context of Orissa, it is believed that this actually began somewhere maybe in the 12th century, where it was primarily in a form that it was sung. So the singing was a very important aspect, and by the 18th century, and of course I think in the 12th century when one looks at it, then obviously one can relate it totally to the whole idea of the Bhakti movement and so on. So in the 18th century, of course, use of Vaishnavite legends or legends about Ram, these were groups, they were then formed, and compared to the Bengal Jatra in Orissa, the singing continued to be very, very important. So everything from the traditional Odissi to Hindustani classical, as Dhirendash has pointed out, there was a very, very strong impact in the Jatra form in Orissa. So if we look broadly at the structure of the Jatra in Orissa, so there's a prelude, and there is a dance by a teenage boy, and one needs to keep in mind that primarily, earlier on, all the roles, for women were also going to be performed by the men. So the young teenage boy would be the curtain raiser, and he would be the gotipua. So then the play would begin, and it is interesting to mark the only prop that is used in the context of the Orissa Jatra is a chair, which could be a throne, it could be anything. So, there is, in a sense, no front side, and there can be audience on all sides and looking at the Jatra. So, some important characters are the Niyati, which of course signifies fate. There is the idea of the Sutradhar. There is a gatekeeper or the Dwari, which is now omitted, but adapting it to the modern theatrical scenario has its own kind of implications. But it's important to understand that when we look at social participation and community activities of this sort happening through the medium of theatre, how it evolves differently in the context of Bengal, and how as singing continues to be an important aspect, so it remains in a different form in Orissa.
You talked about the creative use in the Yatra, and I'm thinking that perhaps in the creative use, the rewriting of certain episodes might also occur. An episode was enacted, let's say, a year ago, and the same party comes and does it again. So, in doing that, I think new elements come in of their own.
Absolutely right. And also because if we look at the very fact that the Jatra when it starts, is something different from, let's say, what it is in the pre-independence period, especially as the whole idea of the Swadeshi Jatra and so on emerged. So I think it allows itself, it is amenable to incorporate new social elements as they are at a particular point in time.
Which means that if in the 19th century, when the freedom movement in a way in the latter half begins, then if something has happened in the city or in the small town or in the village, that also can find a way into the yatra. In the sense that some reference will come somewhere.
Yes.
And naturally it will grow in that direction.
Yes. And so it becomes a way of actually getting people on the same platform, and which has very important nuances in the pre-independence period.
So the point that you make regarding yatra taking place also in the mind of the audience, that is a very profound point.
Yes.
Because that is where the whole thing is forming. It's not just on the stage, it's also in the mind of the audience. They are all the time actively engaged in the performance.
Yes.
That's a point that is very educative.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So and one can see in the context of Orissa, for instance, the whole idea of the conscience or niyati or a sutradhar and so on. So these ideas lead us to imagine how the whole notion of how one should actually function in society, the whole idea of a kind of lived reality that is being presented on stage, and how everybody participates, and it is done in a very, very genial, humorous sort of manner. So something that binds the audience at all times to the performance that takes place on stage. So with this, I think one needs to keep in mind how the jatra is, the journey or the yatra itself is something that aims at a kind of social participation, and is something that takes place in the mind of the audience and allows the audience to then revisit their own lives and to look at how they are kind of leading them and functioning in day-to-day life.
So friends, in this part of the lecture, we have discussed the significance of yatra, its contribution to the cultural life of the people, and the way people start thinking along artistic and social lines. So I think this lecture will continue in the next phase after a short while, and till that time we wait, and then there will be another part of the lecture. Thank you. So friends, we come back to the lecture, and this is the second part, and Dr. Payal Nagpal will extend the argument further with respect to another form under the folk theater forms. So please, Dr. Nagpal.
So we discussed the jatra form, and now we will be looking at the kissa, and the kissa and dastan actually. So when we look at dastan, we are looking at a Persian form, and how stories in Persian, and the whole art of storytelling. So when we look at a dastan, or a kind of a brief story that is to be narrated, so the oral element is extremely important. The fact that it is a story that is to be shared with people. So in a performance, it means that there is an audience that has come to watch, and the primary thrust in a dastan narration, or a narration of a kissa, is on this ability to narrate and recount a story to the audience. And it's those, what are the elements of these dastans or kissas that kind of, you know, create the mood for the narration? So, for instance, there's dastane Amir Hamza and many in these forms. So the stories are about, at times, these are about heroes, the stories are about exotic lands, it's about the heroes and the different women they meet, whom they might marry, they might not marry. Use of the marvelous, and when we talk about the use of the marvelous, then we are also looking at the use of miracles here. And it's the kissa then, in a sense, is a shorter version of the dastan. And you know, where it's interesting to mark that in the 20th century, in the printed form, the kissa continues to flourish, but the dastan undergoes a kind of you know, loss at that minute. And of course, you know, of late, dastan has been revived by a lot of dastan goes. So revived in only the late 20th century. So dastans were narrated, of course, in courts, in bazaars, and there is the example of Emperor Akbar, who was particularly fond of this narration. So an important, you know, a significant aspect of the dastan and kissa is that they are closely entwined, in a sense, with issues of cultural plurality, linguistic heritage, and stem, and they both, of course, stem from Persian traditions. And in the 19th century, the kissa was, in a sense, more popular, was, you know, primarily in Urdu, as in the 19th century, the Persian had given way to Urdu prose. And in Persian, of course, the kissa and dastan, they are described as the same genre. And the kissa is, of course, you know, as mentioned, that because it continues, in a sense, through the 19th and 20th century, it becomes more popular. So, as but around 1830, as Urdu narration increased, as against the Persian, dastans were long kissas, and you know, critics have said that kissas were short dastans. So how these two categories, the use of the dastan and the kissa, really speaking, reads into each other? So the idea is not to make a kind of demarcation, but the period in which the kissa becomes popular has some very important implications, and I will just shortly come to that. But to just give a very, very brief idea about, you know, features of some salient aspects of the dastan, so about handsome princes and paris and magicians, and it is a world of tilism, as it's called, and these names express their roles. So, you know, no change in temperament, and fairly stable, and there is, it is combined, of course, with, you know, the Sufi content. So, it is believed that, you know, the four elements, as Ghalib had said, of dastan were the razm, bazm, tilism, or ayari, and which, of course, in the Iranian tradition was read by Sharar as razm, bazm, husno, ishq, and ayari. So, in South Asian folklore, you know, the encyclopedia explains the dastan, and I quote from there, that it's an extended imaginative narrative, either oral or written. And in pre-modern times, the kissa and the dastan are synonymous. Dastan is linear, episodic, and it has a kind of framing tale. So, and of course, it continues from a much earlier period. So, kissa in that sense, when we come to the kissa, leaving behind the whole, the marvelous of the dastan, when we come to the kissa, it is a short episode that is narrated, that is told, shared with the audience. And this narratorial element becomes very, very important. And with the development of print culture, the kissas continued, in a sense, to shuttle between the oral and the print versions. And again, the listener is an important aspect of the kissa, because the kissa is narrated to people. There is a subtle, nuanced understanding of the kissa, and if you were to imagine the theatrical space here, the implications of a kissa would be very different from, you know, a nautanki or a tamasha or a jatra, for that matter. So the idea is that it is more subtle, it is more nuanced, it is there is a kind of stress on the verbal aspect and how it is shared with the audience. And this is, you know, a significant aspect of the kissa. Here again, I would request Professor Prakash to, you know, share his views on the kissa form.
Oh, well, I think so far as kissa and dastan are concerned, as you point out, are verbal forms, words are used, and there is a narrator. And if there is a narrator, then there is a story. And that story is supposed to be narrated, keeping in view the interest of the audience. So it's a different kind of performance. And secondly, I take the cue from you, from your point, regarding the Qissa and Dastan representing, recreating a scene which existed earlier with the help of characters. Mm. But the teller of the tale is just one person, I believe, the individual who talks to the audience, who tells them what happened in the past. And if the happening is talism, or if the happening is magic, or if the happening is, you know, something, some kind of mystery or miracle, then all the spirit of these things would be conveyed to the audience by the speaker through the word. Right. So would you then say that it's a kind of solo performance of the narrator?
Yes, and a very important one, because, you know, for instance, here the onus in a sense rests very majorly on the performer about what are the points, what are the aspects of the Qissa that the narrator is going to highlight. I think that will determine the flow of the way the audience understands the Qissa. And, you know, a Qissa will have many aspects to it. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, if we were to read a short story today, it would have many aspects to it. Mm-hmm. So, when a Qissa is narrated, what is, I think it depends entirely on the narrator as to his use of particular tone, of a particular nuance, of, you know, of a use of a particular mood. And that is what is going to create the mood of the entire Qissa, which, and the way it will be understood by the audience.
Which means there is no dance, there is no music, there is no singing, it's only the telling.
The telling.
The narration. And as you point out, in the narration, it will be the going up of the tone, the coming down of the tone, the softness, the rudeness, the heart things, you know, all these things will come through the tone only.
Right.
And would the narrator be performing or just telling? I believe that the narrator would have one's eye on the audience, what they like to hear, what excites them, what interests them, and that he would be using only words.
Yes. Only words. And for instance, and the words, of course, as I said, that, you know, the mood is going to be created by the teller in that sense. Because, for instance, we often say ek kissa sunate hain. So the how we even this very sentence can be used and spoken in many different ways to create a mood of horror, to create interest, to create anxiety, to create the exotic. So many different ways of actually presenting the same sentence.
So partly the Qissa is also being created by the audience, because when they nod, then the narrator becomes interested, becomes inspired, and starts, you know, telling on telling that point more and more.
Absolutely. So for instance, if there is a particular a point at which the audience is it could be a very, very exotic sort of tale that's being told, or maybe a funny character that's being talked about. So if the audience kind of gives a very good response at that moment, I'm sure the teller would kind of go on in great detail on that one particular aspect. Now in another narration of the same Qissa, for instance, let's say the next day the same Qissa is being narrated, the audience might respond to a very different aspect of the Qissa, and the teller would then focus on that day on a totally different aspect, creating different moods, so to say.
Would the narrator be using the technique of mime, mimicry, that is?
I think more than mime, I think gesture. Yes, mime, of course, but gesture, I think, is something that will predominate. The use of hands, the use of expression, that would certainly be there. So it would be a performance, but a performance of a very different kind.
If in the Qissa, a kind of dialogue is being presented between a woman and a man, so when the woman's dialogue comes, then the performer, the narrator, will perhaps use the softer tone.
Yes.
So that way the person becomes the performer.
Performer.
Becomes an actor, but using mainly words.
Words.
And the flow. How far is flow important in a Qissa?
Flow is very important, because I think it's almost as if the teller has to, grip the audience's imagination and mind there. So the flow is important, and if there is to be a break in the flow, I think it has to be deliberate. It has to be, maybe a pause that is used by the narrator. So it has to be a well thought of one. Otherwise, the flow is something that needs to be maintained and kept.
And I've heard that these days this form is being revived in Delhi, for instance, and you might have attended one or two performances. Have you attended?
Yes, yes, many such.
Please tell us about that.
So it's being revived in the form of Dastan Goi, and there are many performances, and in fact now I think there are also women as Dastan Goi, so I haven't attended any one of those. Mm-hmm. But the whole idea is that, you know, when these tales from Hamza being recounted, they have, there is a play on words. There is a reason why certain tales are being picked up and they are being recounted. And these tales at times are also adapted and they make a comment on the immediate context, mm-hmm. whatever that context be, it could relate to anything at all. And this, the connection between, you know, and which is where I think Dastan Goi becomes very, very relevant. It cannot simply be a tale that presents the exotic in a way that it has no relationship with the present context. Mm-hmm. In fact, Dastan Goi connects these two contexts. Mm-hmm. It presents these tales, the marvelous in a sense, that a Dastan particularly is endowed with, is connected to the present moment. Mm-hmm. And I think there Dastan Goi is performing a very important function.
And with respect to the use of Persian, was Persian used, or the influence of the Persian tales came here? And because in Qissa, when you say something, then the audience should understand. And since the audience in India would be understanding dialects in Bengal, in Odisha, in North India, in Rajasthan, so the local dialects should be used. But the influence and themes will come from the Persian.
Absolutely. The structure, in fact, I'll, in the context of the Qissa, this is just something I'm just going to mention, that the structure comes from the Persian. Hmm. But the use of the dialect and the use of the context, especially Qissa, as it was very popular in the context of Punjab. Hmm. So there, you know, these two kind of really blend very well. And the Qissa itself as a structure becomes one where it incorporates, in a sense, at the level of the many dialects and overarching Persian structure, and yet at the same time, the concerns remain the concerns of the ordinary people. Mm-hmm. So all these things are kind of put together in the form of the Qissa.
Since you're going to talk about it, so yes. Please proceed.
Yes. Especially, and this is to do with the 19th century and the whole idea of the Qissa, especially in the context of Punjab, where, you know, the Qissa, in a sense, blends together Sufi ideas with the idea of romance. So where the stories of that were part of Dastan centered more on, you know, kind of adventure, and there was a quest of some sort. In the context of the Qissa, it was more to do with, you know, a kind of romance that is blended with Sufi ideas. So many languages, as is just pointed out, the Qissa mingles many languages in categories. Not just languages, categories as well. So there is the oral form, there is then, you know, much later in the 19th century with the advent of the printing press and so on, there is a written form and there is a printed form later. There is a narrative, there is Persian, there are dialects, and there are many forms in which these Qissas are kind of presented. So if we look at, you know, a short Dastan in which the real, so to say, the real concerns of the people and the whole idea of the exotic or the marvelous that comes from the Persian tradition, so, and at the level of language, to move from Persian to Dakhani Urdu, or to move from the royal courts to the bazaars, as Kumkum Sangari has talked in detail about it. So the oral to the written is something that is a much later transition. So there are many Qissas. There is a Qissa that Kumkum Sangari recounts in her essay on Chabili Bhatyari, Sikandar Shah Badshah ke Shahzade Raman Shah ka Qissa. So, you know, and how, you know, it is a Qissa that brings together the ideas of the royalty, ideas of, you know, women, a woman of the royalty, a woman who does not belong to the royalty, who comes from the ordinary masses, and you know, how she tries to protect her own rights, and of course how she is dealt with very brutally towards the end of this Qissa. So another interesting aspect of the Qissa is, for instance, if we look at the Chabhili Bhatyari Qissa, it is in four versions, as Sangari points out. You have, there is a Muslim version, there is a Banya version, there is an Urdu edition, and so on. So which means that the Qissa, when it is written by different people, it becomes a different Qissa. When it is recounted and narrated in terms of a performance in front of a different audience, it is a different kind of Qissa. So it is not located in faraway lands as generally happens in the context of the Persian tales, but it is located in the here and now. So comments on the immediate context of, let's say, the viewers who are the audience, that is, you know, hearing a Qissa being narrated and watching a person narrating that Qissa. So depending on the strength of the person who's telling the story, a particular important event or a particular event that has happened in the village, in the society, is something that can become part of that Qissa. So the here and the now in the Qissa, in that sense, becomes very, very significant. So, and there is, in that sense, a kind of historicity to a Qissa that is, cut across by various other factors, such as those of time. There is a point of view of the audience, and of course, the historical context of the audience and the language. Another very important aspect that Kumkum Sangari draws attention to is that the Qissa emerges much earlier and becomes very popular in the context of the 19th century India, it is not divided on the lines of different sects and communities, but the largely Persio-Islamic tradition remains, and the problems of the people who are watching that Qissa and recounting it continue to remain an integral part, which means that the category of the Qissa as we understand it in the 19th century also becomes a category that is inclusive, and it talks about plurality then at many levels. These are pluralities of experience, pluralities of beliefs, of faiths, languages, dialects, and of course, in that sense, a form that is constantly undergoing a kind of change. So at a time when there is a kind of division that is being created in the society along various faiths and beliefs in the 19th century, the Qissa tradition is a composite that, kind of defies it, because overarching structure remains that of the Persian one. And this is something that has been pointed out by many people, and I would request Professor Prakash to please comment on this particular aspect of the Qissa, which I think is very important, the kind of plurality that it involves and engages us in.
Definitely. In fact, when you are talking about this plurality, when there are different voices and there are aspects coming not merely from the tradition but also from the context when the Qissa is presented, these things also create background of new forms in literature. And I would like to ask you, just make a query regarding the origins of the novel in India. Mm. Because novel is a kind of a narration, where the novelist as an author writes through the print medium for people to understand. And the author is the narrator. The author is actually doing a Qissa. In fact, in Hindi, yes, criticism, there is a word Qissa Goi. Mm. And Premchand is accused of being Qissa Go, mm, the person who is telling things. In fact, good example of Premchand having connection with Qissa in the 19th century, he started writing in the last decade of the 19th century. He was interested in reading, there was a person called Ratanath Sharshar, and he would write Qissas and they would be presented. And in fact, Premchand has translated those Qissas from Urdu into Hindi. They are available today. Mm. So, origins of new forms occur only because the kind of plurality that you talk was there.
Yes.
So there is this clash, there are different voices, there are different planes of understanding and thinking, and people start then saying, okay, now we can have an audience in front of us, but there is another audience which we can reach through the printed word. So maybe origins of the novel in India, they are there in the Qissa.
And
and this other thing.
You're absolutely right on this part, because this is the reason why the Qissa actually in a sense survives. Whereas the dastan for, you know, a lot of people who've researched on this have felt that the dastan was actually lost in during this period. But the Qissa survives. Mm-hmm. And especially because of the printed form, the emergence of the printed form. So the Qissa as being, a story that is being told, is being narrated. So the oral aspect is there. A Qissa that is being written, and the Qissa could be written by different people, which will lead to different versions of a Qissa. Mm. And of course, then comes the print form, which of course later on leads to, you know, many Qissas coming together in a sense in the form of the novel, as you just pointed out. So yes, that aspect is there, and the Qissa in that sense is a strong category or a structure or a form that is there in the 19th century. And the plurality, of course, allows it to lend itself to newer forms, especially with the emergence of the print form.
But has novel replaced the Qissa, or has novel also allowed Qissa to come forward today? Because now, as you say, that there are people who come with the Qissa and they talk to a live audience.
Yes. So I think where the Qissa has continued, maybe in the print form, and undergone a kind of, I would like to believe that, especially maybe not in the context of the city, but in the context of, let's say, other places, and moving away from the very so-called technologically advanced modern cities. When we move to other places and other spaces and villages and far-flung places, I think the Qissa will never go. It will retain its validity. That would always be there.
Particularly in a country, you know, where illiteracy is still the case.
Yes.
So Qissa can travel from one place to another, and people can learn.
And the Qissa, when it travels even from one village to another, I wonder, you know, the kind of transformations that a Qissa mm-hmm. would undergo if the same teller, mm-hmm. let's say, moved from one village to another. Mm-hmm. The Qissa would undergo a change, because the Qissa does, in that sense, kind of deal with the immediate and make a comment and, include in the story something that is happening, let's say, in that space.
So, and maybe a new character is added?
Maybe a new character is added, and that character could just be maybe a character from the audience. Mm-hmm. And suddenly, Qissa could actually point out towards somebody in the audience and make that person a fictitious character who's just been added to the
Qissa. Or maybe an incident took place in some part of the country, it was reported in the newspaper. The Qissa go read it,
yes.
And he or she, you know, starts, you know, telling that Qissa again in a new form.
Yes, that is certainly there. And in fact, Dastangoi, that's now been around for some years and has been recounted. So the form that they use is that of a takht. So a takht is used, and there are these two people, not one, but there are these two people who narrate long dastans. Mm-hmm. And it goes on at times for about an hour and a half. Mm-hmm. And so on. So, and of course, they make very sharp comments and observations, and they pertain to our, immediate lives.
Do they tell jokes?
Yes, they tell jokes. Humor is a very, very important aspect again of, in fact, if we look at the entire string, whether it's tamasha, nautanki, or it's the jatra form, or it's the Qissa or dastan. So all the folk theatre forms, in their own different ways, make use of humor.
So finally, it comes very near what you said about Brecht.
Yes.
Because these two people on the takht, sitting on the takht, they become actors.
They become actors.
And if one of them is a woman, there is a man, then the audience starts, participating in a different manner.
Yes.
So some of them support the woman, some others support the man, and the play begins.
Yes.
So Qissa becomes a play in that sense.
Yes. It becomes a play in that sense. And it is, even if, like for instance, dastans might go on, by the term itself, the dastan might be longer and the Qissa might be the shorter version in that sense. But these are performances, and these are performances of different kinds. So it may not be the a performance that makes use of song and dance in that sense, but it is a performance of a totally different kind.
And in the Qissa, one aspect showed a character, and when the next thing happened, then another character came in and took center stage. So the Qissa itself changes from within.
From within. And again, the point that you made about, you know, the qissa and the novel, did the novel kind of, you know, in a sense, take over the qissa. I think the qissa continued to retain its presence, not only in the oral, but also in the written and printed form. Mm. And where, you know, the novel might be connected as a genre, might be connected to the qissa, but the qissa continues to retain its relevance. And it is, I think it's a powerful medium of actually communicating with the society, with the audience that is listening to, you know, the qissa go in that form. So, and in that sense, when we look at the qissa, we are relating it to late 19th century cultural history, and as pointed out, that this was also the time when, you know, the emergence of sharp lines along which people were going to kind of, you know, move in terms of different beliefs and faiths. The qissa continues in its very composite manner. So, for instance, there is the Heer Ranja and the script of the qissa Heer Jog Singh, which is in 1882, is in Indo-Persian, and the qissa Heer Te Ranjada is in Gurmukhi, and it is somewhere in written down in 1889. So, and how this the fluidity that is there in this particular structure, because it is something that is spoken, the oral is the primary form, and then of course it is written down and it is printed. So this the imagination that is used in the context of the qissa is then of a different sort, and as mentioned, that it is a performance that is of a very different sort. So when we look at folk theatre forms such as jatra, such as qissa, then we are looking at a very strong connection between the popular, the audience that is watching a performance. The nature of the performance might be different, the nature of the performance might change. Within a specific category, the nature of the performance might change from one show to another, but it is an important way in which the entire society and community participates. And that is the strength of the folk theatre forms.
Thank you, Dr. Payal Nagpal, for your lecture. It covered, two very important art forms. You call them folk theatre forms, Jatra and Qissa, and the two perform different kinds of roles in parts of the country that relate to one or the other. And so far as Jatra is concerned, it is participatory in the dramatic sense, and Qissa, which involves the audience's interest more than the audience's participation in that sense. So the two forms are quite rich in their connotations, in their role in society, and in the cultural upliftment. So with this lecture, friends, we come to the end of the folk theatre forms area, and we'll be taking up other issues under this series later on. So thanks, Dr. Payal Nagpal, for this scintillating lecture, and our audience, we'll be interested in knowing more and more from you regarding questions, regarding observations, and you can write down to us. And the phone number is always available. You can participate directly in the program. The number 1-800-110-430, and we'll be in touch regularly under this scheme. Thank you.